Hey folks, David Frost, my strategic forecast. You're here for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis. Today is Thursday, September 19, 2018. We're looking at a daily chart of the SPY or Spider, which is the proxy for the S&P 500. So a couple of things, a little housekeeping before we get rolling here. You'll notice I took the lines off the screen from yesterday. We saw some green support lines on the screen. I'm going to reinstitute those when we need them on the way down, whenever the market decides to begin its trek lower. Right now, we're on a trek higher. There's no reason to confuse the issue right now. We had a down day the other day. We had a reversal yesterday. We had a higher close today. The market remains in an uptrend. Let's not worry about the downside until we have cause to do so. We need to see the signs and a signal of a trend change, and we'll begin worrying about support levels. Right now, let's talk about where we are, where we're likely headed, what I've mapped out, kind of getting inside my mind. As you know, is a dangerous place to be. There is one trend line on the screen. I'm going to take it off, but I'll tell you what it was or what it is. So right now, as far as I'm concerned, I wanted to see the Spider's close above 291 today. That was important to me. That happened. That was a number that would tell me that the odds are beginning to lean in favor of more upside in this market, meaning let's go ahead and make higher highs. I just had an email communication from one of the subscribers, one of the traders that have taken my courses, and the conversation went like this. He was commenting on the bearish pattern in the IWM. We'll get to that in a moment. And then, you know, also that it was getting a little tricky because there begin to develop some divergences out here. And it looks like the market wants to do one thing. You look around and all of a sudden you see some of the things doing other things. And it looks like the market gets or is getting somewhat disjointed. And he's 100% right. And this normally happens prior to the market making a larger move. And we'll talk more about that in a second. And I'm also going to explain a little bit about a couple of positions that I have on now, and I'll explain why, and it goes together with that email conversation that I just discussed. Before we move on, let me pause here for a second and thank everybody for continuing to participate in posting comments underneath the video each and every night. They're helpful comments. I love the interaction. Please keep up the great work. I love the insight. Everybody has something important to say. Please go ahead and say it. In addition, please hit the like button on the video and share the video with those people you think can benefit from this information. Okay, let's get back to the Spider. Here's what I think is going on. Now, this is somewhat of a hypothetical. I'm giving you a schematic about what I think is taking place right here, right in this time zone within the next several days and then beyond. So what I think is taking place is I think the market is going to make new highs. Again, this is hypothetical. I'm not necessarily making a technical forecast, and I'm certainly not telling anybody what to do. I will tell you what I did after the fact, but what I think is taking place is I think the market is going to make higher highs. How much higher right now? I can't really say that we should get much past maybe 293, maybe as high as 293.50, maybe a little bit short of 293 in the Spider. That's what I have my eye on as we move higher. So let's just say that that happens. At that point, we're either going to take off to the upside and not look back and have a whole nother leg to the upside. That's certainly a possibility. I'm not necessarily anticipating that, but I'm certainly aware that that can happen. So I'm aware that, and what I'm about to tell you in a minute or so, it will impact one of the positions I have. I'm aware that could happen, and we'll certainly get signs and a signal if that's going to happen. One of them would be if we get a high volume day where we go higher, finish on the highs, and continue higher with some continuation or some follow through. That will be a pretty good indication that we're not going to see a sign and a signal of a trend change anytime soon. Now, if I'm right, again, this is a hypothetical, but if I'm right and we do go higher, make higher highs, do turn around somewhere in the neighborhood, maybe it's 293, maybe it's 294, somewhere in that neck of the woods, if we do put in a sign and a signal of a trend change, these are things that are found in the course at Lazy E-Mini Trader. Once we see that develop, that's at the point in which I believe the market is likely to turn around and work off some of this overbought condition. Now, on the daily chart, doesn't look like much of an overbought condition. We're in an uptrend. We're hugging along the home base or 20-period moving average. So what's so overbought about that condition? Yeah, the 50-period moving average is sloping up. It's running parallel to the 20. That's a pretty good sign. Same thing with the 100. There's not much overbought on the daily chart. You would be right. Let's say we did push higher and we did so rapidly. We would get rapidly overbought on the daily chart. But here's what I'm also looking at. And I have more to this story, so stay with me on this. I go over to the weekly chart and I say, well, the weekly chart is getting pretty extended from home base. That's a different scenario. We've seen it extended before, and it certainly can get extended, but it's getting into that neighborhood where it's extended from home base or the 20-period moving average. That's the red upsloping trend line. So I would say that if we're in the ballpark of my hypothetical scenario and the market has a quick run higher for a few days, right? $2-3 higher in the spider, something like that. 20-30 handles in the S&P. Everybody gets giddy. There's all of a sudden new highs being made. We have new forecasts by all the genius analysts that run through CNBC and other stations, and they start calling for much higher highs of all the indexes in throughout the end of this year. And that's at the point in which we see a sign or a signal of a trend change. The market turns around and it begins downward, and we have some kind of a correction that lasts for several weeks. That's what I have my eye on. I don't know if it's going to play out like that, but that's the visual. That's my mind's eye. That's visually what my mind has its eye on. Well, obviously, play it one day at a time. I will play it in real time, and now I'll tell you what I have on in terms of positions as it relates to the direction of the market. And when I say that, you have to keep in mind that I'm a trader. I have some longer term swing trades on. I have some intraday trades that I trade. I trade a lot of stocks, but I do like to trade the direction of the indices. A, it keeps me sharp. B, I talk about it each and every day. I look at it all day long. If I believe something is going to happen, why would I not try and make money off of that concept? As long as I have something to trade against, I know where I'm wrong, and so on. I use all the things that I teach and that traders learn from the comprehensive course at Lazy E-Mini Trader. It applies to everything, both intraday, on out through swing trading, and also into investing. All charts act and react the same way. So with all that being said, let's go back to the daily chart, and I'm going to tell you what I have on as we speak, okay? I have a long trade on in the spider. I have a long trade meaning I have an option on the spider, so I know my maximum risk. So I'm not going to wake up and find the gap down of an enormous amount, you know, 50 points in the spider, and it goes down 100 points, or 50 points in the S&P, and it goes down 100 points by a quarter to 10 in the morning. You know, I'm not going to find myself in a scenario where I can really get hit pretty hard. I have an option. I don't have a large option position. Why is that? Because I know in my heart of hearts, or at least I believe, there's not a lot of upside left. Therefore, I want to take advantage of the upside I believe that exists. However, it's a small position, so my worst case is I lose the entire premium. Am I likely to lose the entire premium? No, I'm not. Why is that? Because if I believe we begin, let's say, begin closing hourly below 291, I said to me that's an important number, and we begin closing hourly and then 2 hours below 291, I may decide to pitch that position, cut and run, take a loss, lick my wounds, and move on. That's the way it works. But I also have on a longer term position on the IWM on the short side. And speaking of the IWM, since we've pretty much exhausted everything I need to tell you today about the spider, we don't need to talk about the downside of the spider. We know that, well, we can. We know the downside of the spider. We're going to use the low from the other day as the line in the sand for the time being on the daily chart. That would be from a swing training perspective. The low is 289.03. Close below that, the spider's in trouble. You can use 291 if you want, but that's a very, very tight stop. I'm using that because it's a short-term option. It's not expiring Friday for those of you that would have asked in an email. However, it's a small position, but I don't necessarily want to lose the whole premium. I'm playing for something that if I think is going to happen, which I do, is likely to happen between now and early next week. If it's not going to happen by early next week, it's probably not going to happen, and therefore we're probably going in the other direction. Those are the trades I have on as it relates to market direction. Now here's the IWM. I just told you that I was short a longer term option in the IWM. So I have plenty of time for this to work out. However, I do have gateways, or I do have lines in the sand where I'm not necessarily going to stick around. I'm going to be wrong small and fast if I'm going to be wrong in the IWM. That's another thing that traders learn when they take the course, is how to be wrong small and fast. Look, we have to face the fact we're going to be wrong on trades. That's just the way it works. So I'm satisfied saying I'm short the IWM against, there's two breakdown candle highs. There's this one from the 17th, and there's also this one from the 6th, both from September. So I can make a choice. If we close above the high from the 17th, I can sell the position, I can sell half of the position, and I can wait out the other half and see what happens at the next level, the high from the 6th of September. I have, no pun intended, I have options or choices with my option, and that's one of the reasons why I choose to play the indexes using options a lot of times, because I'll use one or two versus the other. I'm not afraid to trade long the spider and short another vehicle that happens to be in a bearish formation. Now, it doesn't happen often in the indexes, but I'm certainly happy to do it. And with this, I put on what's called a time spread. Because if the upside is going to play out in my book, it's going to happen sooner than later. And if it does, what I'm also happy to do is, I'm also happy to add to the IWM short position. If it begins to play out as I have it mapped out in my mind, I'll most likely add to the short position if we get the spike higher I'm anticipating. I don't know exactly if I'll do that. However, I'm going to leave myself open to the idea that I might want to do that and certainly trade it and play it in real time. So let's talk about the IWM. We're hovering over the 50 period moving average. If that's going to hold, the market, or in this case, the IWM, and as a side note, you all know that it's my favorite market leading indicator. I feel the need to say that each and every night. But if the market's going to turn around and the 50 is going to hold, then it's going to get above this high from the 17th. That high is at 171.54. And if we begin closing above that high, and if we close above it, certainly on a daily basis, you know, we're going to start looking in the other direction. We're going to start looking north. Maybe this is just a pullback in a larger uptrend. So we always want to go over to the weekly chart. And what do we see from a weekly chart perspective? We see a market that certainly is in an uptrend. We're actually working our way from a weekly chart perspective back toward home base. So when you look at this, two things could be going on. There's nothing wrong with this chart. That's thing number A, right? And we can certainly just turn around and continue up. We had a pullback for a few weeks, and there's nothing wrong with that. That's garden variety market behavior. We have a couple of other things on the chart, right? We have a breakup candle low right here. Does this coincide with the weekly 20 period moving average or home base? Well, not exactly, but almost. So as time goes on, the weekly moving average creeps higher, and that may coincide with the low of that breakup candle. What is that breakup candle? That's the candle from the week ending August 24th. The low happens to be 167.83. It's not that far away from where we are right now. I go back to the daily chart and I want to take a look. Where's 167.83? Well, 167.83 happens to be right here, 167.83. Let's put it where it is, 167.82. That's close enough. Take that back. It wasn't close enough. I had to pause the video and put it at 167.83. I told you my mind is a dangerous place to be. But look at all this chart consolidation down in that area. Forget the number. I use the number as a guideline to take me to the next step of what I want to look at. So I take the number from the weekly chart. Now I go back to the daily chart and I say, what does the chart look like in and around that number? Well, A, we have a term that I use often, chart vibration. So you can see we traded in and around that number quite a bit, right? We definitely find that somewhere in the vicinity of that number is important. All of a sudden, we see a daily low. The low happens to be exactly on that number that day. Okay, that was the 20th of August, okay? That's interesting. We don't necessarily need to have that information, but it's good to have. So we know that there's a likelihood, if in fact the IWM gets down and around 167.83, 168, 167.50, somewhere in that zone, we know we have to begin looking for chart support. What does that mean if you're in a position and you're in a short trade, for example, under this scenario? What does that mean? What are you likely to do? What should you do? I should rephrase it. What should you do? You should take off part of the position. Why? Because in and around an area where there's likely chart support, you're likely to get some kind of a bounce off that level and a rally. Maybe the rally lasts for 2, 3, 4 days. We don't know. Maybe it lasts for 15 minutes or a couple of hours. We really don't know. Depends on what's happening in the market at that time. Maybe it's one of those days where everything just blows through their numbers. Well, you'll be able to recognize it if that's taking place, and you're likely to want to see more and see it play out a little more if everything is getting thrown out with the bathwater. But you have to use your judgment in real time at that time. Look what else we have around that price. I'm just noticing this. I just find it interesting how the market repeats around the same numbers for different reasons. We have a breakdown candle, and we have a bearish wedge pattern that rallies back to test the high of the breakdown candle. We all know that routine, right? So it does that, and that happens to be right around the same price we're talking about right now, right around that 167.83, give or take, whatever you want, out of that number. So we know that that number is going to be important. So you have to book some profits along the way when you're taking a trade. So let's just use an easy example. We'll use shares and we'll use 1,000 shares of whatever, okay? If you have 1,000 shares of whatever and you're playing for a correction, that would be a good area to take off 20, 33, maybe even 50% of the trade, and you let the rest go and you never let the trade go against you. If the market should turn around and you get to the point where you're about break even, maybe you decide to take the trade off and say, okay, it was a winning trade, didn't work out like I thought it would, and you move on to the next trade. There's always another trade around the corner. Sometimes you'll do that. The trade will then turn around again, and it will go down without you being involved. That does happen. That's the way the market has to trick, trap, fool, and frustrate as many traders as possible. That's going to happen one way or the other. But if you want to be the conservative, business-like trader, that's what you would do. You book some profit and you see what happens. If it continues down, you book some profit at the next obvious support level on the downside. I'll leave you with this on this topic. Gamblers are the ones that try and hold a position all the way to final target, and that's provided they even know what final target is. That's not the prudent way to run a trading business. Think about that for a second and think about the way you trade your individual account and see if it doesn't make sense to do it a different way. Just play around with it a little bit. Play around with it on paper in some hypothetical trades. See what would have happened. It's not about the money that you would have made had you held. It's about the money that you don't lose by employing a strategy around sound money management practices. We have to move it along. The transports, nothing happened in the transports, so the story doesn't change. the transports is going sideways. When this happens, it's likely building energy for another move higher. Now, at some point, we're at a high on a chart. So at some point, these bearish patterns do fail because at some point, you will run up against the high in the transports like any other chart. There's always an absolute high at some point. But we just run the charts how we run the charts. And right now, this is in an uptrend. It's making another a bullish pattern. And that being said, it's likely to push higher. If, in fact, we begin closing daily below the low of this breakup candle, then you know the other thing is happening, and you know there's likely a failure on our hands. The low is 11,377 and change. And that's how you manage the market one step at a time and never really take a whopper of a loss by knowing where you're wrong and having it be relatively small and fast. How about the Qs? Now, interestingly enough, the Qs were flat today. Now, what we'll find is the financials were up big. We'll get to that in a moment. The transports were flat. The S&P was up 3.5 points. That's close enough to flat. The Dow was up rather large, and the NASDAQ was down 6 points or flat. The Qs, we'll just call it flat. But here again, we have to take notice of where we are on the chart. The S&P looks like it wants to make new highs, but that's the only market that looks like that against the Qs and the IWM, for example. Again, what that also tells me, and it also supports my case, that for whatever the reason, the S&P looks to me like it wants to make new highs. Now, I could be completely wrong. What I'm looking at, somebody else is looking at something different, saying, he's absolutely bananas, here's what it looks like, and it looks bearish, and here's why. And that's fine, that's what makes a market. There's always multiple ways to look at a chart, and that's what makes a market, is there's people that look at the same thing and see two totally and entirely different things or different outcomes at hand. So that's what makes a market. So I see what I see. I see an S&P that wants to push higher, right? At least temporarily. But I also see Qs in the IWM that look bearish. This is a bearish pattern. You know, if we start getting above the 20-period moving average and closing well and getting above some other levels, that's different. I'll change my tune. But that's not what's on the chart today. I can only go by what's on the chart today. So again, what I can see happening is I can see us in the S&P making a quick spike higher, you know, turning around at some point. These markets, like the Qs and the IWM, never making new highs and ultimately going lower. And that's the divergence that we'll look back and say, see, those markets were diverging. Well, I'm telling you what I see ahead of time. Forget about the people that come back over the top, you know, weeks later and say, well, this is why that happened, and this is how you'll know for next time. No, this is how you should know for now. There is no next time. Next time is the next trade. All right, let's move on. I think I got a little excited right there. XBD was up nicely today. So again, I want to talk about this market as it relates to my case for what I discussed earlier. XBD's up almost 1.5% today. That's a big day for the broker-dealer index, right? So it's trying to recover. We got above the 20 into the 50-period moving average, and that's where we found enough was enough for today. Okay, so let's say there's higher prices coming. We know that it's unlikely that the market is going in the downward or southern direction with the financials going north. It just doesn't work like that, not for an extended period of time. Sure, one day to the next, markets diverge. It's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the larger picture. Look at the XLF. Look at this day in the XLF. What was the cause of the XLF having a tremendous day? So what did the XLF do? So here's the way I see it. When I look at a chart, here's the first thing I see. I see an up move. I see a pullback. I see another up move. I see an ABC pattern, and I see us getting above the high of the A leg. We talk about this over and over and over again. And folks, this is just one of the things among many, many others that's discussed and taught in the course at Lazy E-Mini Trader. So look what happened. We had a pullback. The moving averages supported price. We talked about it. I said, as long as we stay above these, if we can jump above the 20, then we're back in business. And guess what? We were back in business all in one bite. Unfortunately, it didn't give you an opportunity to play. But look at this move in the XLF. Is this a market telling us that everything's going to turn down and the trap door is going to open and the S&P 500 is going to fall out of bed? No, not today. It's not. Now, I talk about the IWM and the transports as my number one and two favorite market leading indicators, and that's true. But certainly the XLF, or the financial sector as a whole, has importance. Now, on the flip side, let's talk technology. The SOX, the Philadelphia Semiconductor Index, didn't do anything today. Was flat. Technology was flat. Financial screamed higher. You're seeing money rotate around. When money rotates around like this, it's the beginning, or not the beginning per se, but it's part and parcel of a larger move at hand. I talked about that earlier in the video. Keep that in the back of your mind. We're seeing interesting rotations in money. Nothing happened in the SOX. This is still, in my book, an unresolved market. I can make a case there's a bearish pattern here. I can make a case a bearish pattern played out and we snap back. What do you do with that? You just leave it alone. You don't do anything with that right now. The SMH, same thing. I can make a case it's a bearish pattern, but here's an anomaly down here. And when there's an anomaly on the screen, you have to move along. You don't trade an anomaly. It's not worth the risk. You find a chart pattern where there's not an anomaly. That puts the probabilities that you're going to make money and be successful in your favor. When I see this, it looks like a bearish pattern. Look where the moving averages are. We can't seem to get above them. If we got above them, I might change my tune, at least temporarily. Looks like it wants to break down, but we already broke down. So I don't want to trade that. There's an anomaly on the screen. Let's move along. So now we talk about gold. In fact, gold, we had these lines on the screen from a shorter time frame. Let's go back to that time frame and let's see what we have. Remember, we had that pattern that looked like it wanted to go higher. And what happens is it did go higher, but the trouble is it made the pattern a second time. And so ultimately we did go higher. The first target was 1209 spot 90. And then we have another target at 1212 spot 40 or higher. And this is what's going on. Let's take away these lines on the screen for a second so the daily chart is not muddied. Okay. So that was just for fun. Wanted to see a pattern played out. The pattern played out, but the pattern had to repeat a second time. It was one of those play it again Sams. Here's the larger pattern, and you can trade smaller time frames within the larger pattern. And when I say can, you should be trading smaller time frames within the larger time frame, the larger pattern. The larger pattern right now in gold is a bullish pattern. We have an up move. That's a bullish breakup candle. So we know where we're wrong, right? So in this case, on the shorter time frames, when you go down to shorter charts, 10-minute chart, hourly charts, whatever chart you want to look at, you can trade the patterns that develop off the shorter time frames that play out in anticipation or as the larger time frame is playing out. And that's the way we trade. Those are the things that are taught, and they're taught how to do that in the course at Lazy E Mini Trader. So no new information in gold. It's doing exactly what we've been discussing that it was going to do off of that daily chart pattern. Now we're looking at crude oil. Crude oil is finally making the move up to the 72 or possibly slightly higher. Call it 72 to 72.50, give or take. The high of this breakdown candle is 72.53. So somewhere in that neighborhood is where crude wants to get to. Boy, it sure has been a long, strange trip it's been to get there. We started talking about it way back here, and what happened is we put in this funky candle. And as soon as we put in that funky candle, I began discussing the fact that I didn't like it, was staying away from it, and here we are. We finally found support at the moving averages. We're moving back up, but it's certainly been a wild ride to get where we are now in crude oil, on our way likely to 72, 72.50 a barrel in crude. When we get there, that's going to be interesting to see what happens when we get there. We should find overhead resistance at that price level. If we close above there, different story altogether. If we can't close above there, could be an interesting short trade on our hands. However, have to see what happens in real time. There's no point in discussing the potential for a trade now until and unless we get to that specific price point. And what's the market doing when we get, or what the market is doing when we get to that price point? And with that, folks, I'm beginning to get tongue-tied. I'm out of wind. I'm going to wrap it here. I'm David Frost, My Strategic Forecast. Thanks for tuning in for another episode of Common Sense Market Analysis.